evening. We'll go ahead and begin this evening. We have a few prayer requests. The first is that Ann Pryor remains in the hospital. She can have visitors, but the family is asking that you please call first, and please keep Ann and the Pryor family in your prayers. Also, Rob Gerst will be having surgery tomorrow, and Tiffany Cotton will meet with her oncologist on Friday, so we need to pray for good news on her behalf. Anyone else that we need to remember? All right, let's begin with prayer. Father God, we're grateful for the day. We thank you for allowing us to enjoy it. We pray that we have used today for your glory. Father, we pray that you would forgive us whenever we fall short of that glory. We pray that you would forgive us whenever we intentionally rebel against your will for our lives. We pray that you would forgive us whenever we sin unintentionally. And we pray, Father, that we would use every day to become more like you so that we could enjoy your presence forever. Father, we pray for Miss Ann, that you would grant her with healing and comfort and peace. And we pray for Rob that his surgery would go well tomorrow and that you would grant him with a full recovery. And we also pray for Tiffany that you would be with her tomorrow and that she would receive good news. We pray that the cancer has not returned. We know that you're a good God and a powerful God and a loving and merciful God. And because of that, you hear us and you act on our behalf and you love us. And we know that you do your will no matter what we ask, but these are the things that we ask according to our own will. We're grateful that you're wiser than that, though. Father, we are grateful for another opportunity to be gathered with our church family and to hear from your word. And we pray that you would speak to us tonight through Billy. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. One announcement. The Backpacks for Kids campaign is ongoing. Please consider making a donation to help us reach our goal of 10,000 students to help students with their school supply fees. The checks will be made for the schools on Tuesday. So let's try to reach that. I think we're getting fairly close, but I forgot what the last update was. Seems like it was around 7,000. Tonight, our speaker is Billy McLean. He's currently the associate minister and deacon at Northside Church of Christ in Benton. And if you're thinking, wait, didn't we already have the Northside guy? Well, we did, but it was a different Northside guy. This one's better. Got on me last week, so that was payback. This may be the first time I've ever invited somebody, and then whenever they walked through the door, it was somebody other than who I thought I invited. So this is great. So I just met Billy. I thought it was a guy that I had had lunch with back in October at lectureship, but it's not. That was a different guy. So I don't know what's going on tonight. Billy's married to Kathy. She's a nurse practitioner at Baptist Hospital in Little Rock. He completed degrees at Harding and Harding School of Theology. He was a missionary at Campo Grande, Brazil for 11 and a half years, and then he preached in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania for 12 years. And then he moved to Central Arkansas in 2005 to teach special ed. He served as an elder at Central Church in Little Rock before he came to Northside. We'll hear from Billy right after Clay leads us in song.
Well, I'll differ a little bit with Corey. Last week you got a good speaker. We are blessed at Northside to have Jim there. He is outstanding. I brag on him all the time, and when I get a chance, so I'll brag to you. You got to hear him last week. But tonight, we're in chapter 16 of the book of Acts. So if you want to go there, either in your Bible or on your phone or whatever you have, check it out. We're going to be looking at a really cool story. And so as you're looking for that, I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to be with you. It's encouraging to be with brothers and sisters whenever you're together. I was talking with one of your elders, Gary, back there, about your life groups. And one of the ideas he didn't know I got this, but I kind of like it, is the idea that you meet every other week in small groups, and then you come together as a large group, I guess, in between. So a lot of good things. It's good to be with other Christians in other places to get good ideas and share those things. Well, Acts chapter 16, I was assigned verses 25 to the end of the chapter, and the title is Faith When You're Afraid. And it's a great title because there's a lot of fearful people in this story. And I'm going to start a little bit earlier than that. But before we get into that, I want to just kind of set this up. In the ninth chapter of Acts, when Paul was kind of given his opportunity to become an apostle, one of the part of the message that was given to him by Ananias, he's told, I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. I mean, that's the first thing that Ananias probably tells Saul. You're going to suffer. If you wish to take up on this mission, you will suffer. And so chapter 16 is one of many examples in Scripture of where Paul suffers for the cause of Christ and suffers here bodily harm. So we'll see that in just a moment. Jesus talked about this idea of suffering. Matthew 10:17 told the apostles that you will be flogged. So all the apostles apparently had that to look forward to. And I don't know about you, but you know, if someone told me at the outset, okay, repent and be baptized, and down the road you're going to be flogged, you know, that might have caused me to just, you know, think a little bit more deeply about the commitment that I was making to Christ. I don't know about you. Would that affect you at all? Yeah, it's a challenging thing that Paul and the apostles were told that this was going to be a part of their way of life from that point on as they followed Jesus. So let's look in chapter 16. The story that leads into this is Paul has made his way over from Asia, or Asia Minor, but that's Asia, over into Europe. And remember the Macedonian call that takes place in the early part of chapter 16. And there's a vision of a man saying, come over to us. And he's in Macedonia, apparently. And so they cross the water, and they make their way over there to Philippi. In Philippi, there's no synagogue, apparently. And so Paul encounters some women who are worshiping God by the river. A few years ago, I was privileged to do some teaching in Haiti at the town of Gonaives. And there's a beautiful mountain kind of up behind the city. And so a couple of young guys climbed this mountain. I had been up there about a year before, and I had a lot of hip pain, so I didn't get to do that climb. But this time I was doing better, so I went up there. And what we found on top of that mountain was a beautiful view, but not only that, it was a place for prayer. There was evidence that a lot of people, probably of a lot of different faiths even, maybe even voodoo, were up there at different times praying because it was a wonderful place to pray. Maybe that was what this was. But he finds Lydia. She's a seller of purple, apparently a wealthy woman. She and her family believe and are baptized. And things are going well, it seems. And then there's a woman who is possessed by a spirit which predicted the future. And this spirit was calling out, these men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved. Now, that's a good message, but not the right person to share that message, I guess. At least not coming from a demonic spirit that's admitting faith in God and telling people to listen to Paul. You want to be careful who you listen to, right? And so Paul gets frustrated with this, and he casts out the spirit. It makes the people upset who have been controlling her and making money from her ability. And so they decide that they're going to throw Paul and Silas, his companion, in verse 19, drag them into the marketplace to face the authorities. They brought them before the magistrates and said, these men are Jews and are throwing our city into an uproar by advocating customs unlawful for us Romans to accept or practice. And that may not seem like a strong argument, but if you think about it, it is. There's not a synagogue, so the Jewish faith is not well known there. They're using government. The laws of Rome are being thwarted, so this is, in a sense, it's undermining what we stand for as a nation, as a people. That's the argument that they're making. And so they're trying to get Paul and Silas thrown into prison. The crowd joins in the attack because this is in the marketplace. After all, this is where business is done. This is where law court is and so on. And so the people kind of start beating up on these two men. The magistrates order them to be stripped and beaten with rods. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison. Now, I've read over that so many times and just kind of passed over, you know, okay, they got beat up, got thrown into prison unfairly. But I got to thinking about that. Some of you seen, probably many of you have seen The Passion of Christ by Mel Gibson. It makes us much more aware of what Jesus went through and what other people who were not citizens of Rome, what they at times went through suffering for the cause of their faith. And so if you can picture a little bit, I didn't even want to go see that movie because I read about it. I knew how harsh it was. And I have only seen it once. Didn't want to go back because it left such an impression. And that's really kind of what the first part, at least, of what Paul and Silas are going through. They've been beaten, stripped. That is bad enough, to be stripped in public, beaten with rods, severely flogged, and then thrown into prison. Now, Paul writes about some of these things in 2 Corinthians. If you want to just check it out, we're not going to go to these, but 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 5, and then more detail in 2 Corinthians 11, verses 23 through 25. And you'll find that Paul went through many times that he was beaten unfairly. And so when we think being beaten up, we may think of a playground brawl, but it was much more than that. So that brings us to our text, and it's the idea of faith when you're afraid. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. Let's start in verse 24. Back up to 23. We'll start there. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once, all the prison doors flew open, and everyone's chains came loose. The jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself, we're all here." The jailer called for lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds. Then immediately he and all his household were baptized. The jailer brought them into his house and set a meal before them. He was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God, he and his whole household. When it was daylight, the magistrates sent their officers to the jailer with the order, "Release those men." The jailer told Paul, "The magistrates have ordered that you and Silas be released. Now you can leave, go in peace." But Paul said to the officers, "They beat us publicly without a trial, even though we are Roman citizens, and threw us into prison. And now do they want to get rid of us quietly? No. Let them come themselves and escort us out." The officers reported this to the magistrates, and when they heard that Paul and Silas were Roman citizens, they were alarmed. They came to appease them and escorted them from the prison, requesting them to leave the city. After Paul and Silas came out of the prison, they went to Lydia's house, where they met with the brothers and sisters and encouraged them. Then they left. All right, there are some really scared folks in this story. The first ones, I would probably say, are Paul and Silas. They've been beaten to probably shreds, and they're in this cell of a prison. By the way, any of you visited Williamsburg, Virginia, at some point? Anybody? Just go ahead and raise your hand. We've got a few. Did you visit Ye Olde Jail? Okay. And that's jail. That's the jail. It's one of the first indoor plumbings in the U.S., so it's a better place than a lot of homes were at the time, in some ways. But I don't know if you knew it, but our early history with jails was that was a holding place until you were given a trial. The punishment was not jail. That was a holding place. Like if you got drunk, that was a holding place, kind of like in Mayberry or something. You know, it was a holding place for the town drunk. So it wasn't really a place of punishment. And the Romans kind of saw it that way too. Sometimes it was the last place you lived before execution if you were a bad person. But usually it was more of a place for waiting for judgment. And so they were put there. But in this case, they were put in the inner cell. My wife and I made a trip to Italy about a month ago, and we were scheduled to visit the Mamertine prison, which is one of those places in Rome that they tell you, this is where Peter and Paul stayed, and this is their last place they stayed. And it could have been. It's a possibility. It was in the public forum of Rome. We didn't get to go. My wife got a little bit sick, so we just kind of backed out of that part of the tour. But I looked up some pictures just to kind of see what that was like. Of course, that's a different place. But it was a hole in the ground, kind of at the sewer level, and it flooded. And so that may have been a place that Paul eventually ended up in. So this prison was probably not quite as nice as ye old jail of Williamsburg, but certainly not a pleasant place to be. But at midnight, these guys, who are undoubtedly somewhat scared about what their fate would be the next day, are singing and praying to God. So we'll come back to them, just because they're probably the key to this story. The second people that we encounter that are scared, our person, is the jailer. The jailer is scared, rightly so. He was tasked with making sure nobody escaped. And if someone was there waiting to be executed the next day, perhaps, or in a couple of days, if he lets that person escape, then his life is going to be taken according to the law. And so you see that idea there, that he's a person that is ready to take his own life, because that was probably, from his perspective, preferable to the Romans doing to him, taking his life. So he's fearful. And so he asks a question, and scholars kind of debate the meaning of this, but he says, what must I do to be saved? And there's two good possibilities. One, he's thinking about his physical life. You know, and so he is concerned about this escaped prisoners, and Paul calls out that everyone is still there. Nobody has left. And so you don't need to be fearful about that. Don't harm yourself. We're all here. But what must I do to be saved? The other possibility is he's been listening, maybe listening to Paul and Silas and what they have been doing during the night, which is praying and singing. So that's a possibility. Maybe he was already thinking about God at this point. So we have these two categories at this point. We have the family introduced soon afterward. And then verse 35, we have the magistrates. Now, these are the judges of the town, the ones that would make decisions as to the fate of Paul and Silas. And so they send officers to release the men. I don't know the reasoning, if it was just so holding for one night. It really wasn't as bad as everybody was saying. Let's get them out of here. But they do that. But when they find out that Paul, and probably Silas, since the sentence is diminished for both of them, are Roman citizens, what does it say about them? Verse 38, they were alarmed. So you've got some fearful folks. So you've got Paul and Silas that don't know their fate during the night, and we're going to learn of what they did, how they handled it. We've got the jailer and his family, and we have the magistrates. The reason the magistrates are in such a tizzy about this is that as Roman citizens, there were certain laws that had been around and on the books for a long time that protected every Roman citizen. I want to read you something here. The Valerian law that was put in place in 508 B.C. declared that if a citizen appealed from the magistrate to the people, it should not be lawful for a magistrate to beat him with rods or to behead him. And that was from Plutarch. By the Porcian law of circa 300 B.C., it was expressly forbidden that a citizen should be beaten. Cicero says that the body of every Roman citizen was inviolable. The Porcian law, he adds, has removed the rod from the body of every Roman citizen. And in his celebrated oration against Verres. I don't know who that is, but he says, a Roman citizen was beaten with rods in the forum. O judges, where in the meantime no groan, no other voice of this unhappy man was heard except the cry, I am a Roman citizen. Take away this hope, he says. Take away this defense from the Roman citizens. Let there be no protection in the cry, I am a Roman citizen. And the praetor can, with impunity, inflict any punishment on him who declares himself a citizen of Rome. All this is to say that it was sacrosanct that a Roman citizen was protected from bodily harm caused by the magistrates or by the tribunal. They couldn't be treated in the way that Paul and Silas were. You may ask, well, why didn't Paul and Silas simply explain at the time of the event that they were Roman citizens? We really don't know. It could be a couple of things. What language probably did Paul most comfortably function in as his second language? Probably Greek, right? But now, although we're in what we today call Greece, Macedonia, Latin probably was spoken in Philippi. It was a Roman colony. And so it may have been a little hard for Paul, if he was saying, I'm a Roman citizen, and someone's beating him on the throat, he's saying it in sort of a Greek or a Hebrew accent. Any of you speak a second language? Can you admit to it? Okay. Well, when you're learning a second language, things aren't always as easy as when you learn it as a child. And we're all aware of people who are learning or speaking a second language, and sometimes it's hard to understand. So it could be the situation. But in any case, toward the end of the story, Paul says, I'm a Roman citizen, and you can't treat us this way. So I want to get into one part of this and then get back to our application. One of the reasons I think that Paul did this was to protect the jailer. You know, we think, well, he's probably protecting himself, right? But they've already told him he can go. And he's not probably really that concerned about all the legal ramifications for the future of Roman law. He's not doing that. But he's probably protecting the jailer and protecting the new church. Because if they're let go but still criticized for this new faith that they're preaching, it reflects badly on people who have adopted this new faith. The church, Lydia and her family, the woman, maybe the woman that he's cast the evil spirit out of, certainly the jailer. And then secondly, the jailer has done something in the middle of the night that no jailer would do to a prisoner. Now, remember what Paul and Silas went through. They were beaten up. Their skin was open. They were flayed. You don't heal or look clean after that the next morning without somebody giving you a bath and some attention. And who's going to do that except the jailer? I mean, that's pretty easy to discover. How in the world are these guys cleaned up? We beat them to a pulp. And so he's protecting the jailer as well. Because if they were illegally beat up, then the jailer was in the right. One other point, and then I want to finally get to the main point of this and talk a little bit about what we do when we're afraid. Sometimes people are bothered when we come to passages that talk about baptism, and maybe it's just a question that comes up. Well, what about the water? You know, where did the water come from to be able to immerse someone in the middle of the night, for example? Well, I want you to pay attention, if you haven't already, to the connection between the washing of the wounds and water being present to also baptize the jailer and his family. It all works out good, doesn't it? God is at work. So the question we really get to is, how is God at work when we're fearful? And when it turns on us today, when we're fearful, is God at work? Can we count on God to be there for us? And this story, if nothing else, illustrates that God cares for his people. Even when things seem awful and unfair and unjust, there are people who are hurt unjustly. There are people who are hurt because of misinformation or an expectation of something that's going to happen. In the case of the jailer ready to take his own life. There's mistakes that are made, and there are consequences, and all of these, Paul and Silas, are part of the story. They suffer the consequences of the crowd's misbehavior. They suffer the consequences of the men who were in control of the slave girl. They suffer the consequences of magistrates who don't take the time to find out who these men are. They suffer the consequences of a type of political situation that's unfair and is poised to try to destroy this new faith in this city, this large city. And so what do you do when you're fearful? Well, the jailer almost took his life, but he was willing to listen to instruction about God. The magistrates were fearful for their lives and made appeasement to Paul and Silas. Maybe not satisfactory from our point of view. You know, why in the world, if you're worried about your own political situation and your judicial situation, why would you ask the guys to leave town? It's kind of like the Old West, out of town by sunset. It's not really probably the best answer, but it shows what can happen. But let's look at Paul and Silas. These are really the key, I think, and maybe a little bit more about the jailer's family. Verse 25 reminds us that Paul and Silas were praying and singing to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. How many of you like to sing in the shower? Yeah, maybe at different times in our life. Like to sing at church. Hopefully everybody likes that. Even when you don't feel good about your own voice, you still like to sing. I hope you do. I hope you know that God's not doesn't really care if you sing well. He gave you the voice that you have. He just wants you to, well, sing. He wants you to sing. So they were singing and praying to God, and other people were listening to them. Now, that's another part of the story. You know, I imagine everybody that was in this prison was a little bit fearful. We didn't talk about them. But they're listening to them praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. There's something, I think, to be said to us today about our behavior. How we behave when we're unguarded is still observed by others. You know, sometimes we're guarded about our behavior. When you come into the church building, we probably kind of get a certain sense of how we ought to behave. We teach our kids, our grandkids, you know, don't run in the church building until after church is over, you know, that sort of thing. And then after church is over, run around, get some energy out. So we have a certain way of doing things. But the point I want to make is these men weren't in a church building. They weren't in a great place. They were probably in a damp place built of stone or bricks or something like that. Maybe even a place dug out of the ground. Yet they're singing praises to God, and people are paying attention. They're listening. Yeah. Yeah. This guy, the jailer, yeah, he was ready to take his own life. That was it for him. That was it. Yeah. And people that do know God ought to know what to do. Sometimes we don't. Sometimes we're fearful. Sometimes we're fearful of what somebody may hear of us. You know, some of us are scared about our voices, you know, singing. I got to be quiet. You know, it doesn't seem to be that way with Paul. You know, it doesn't tell us whether Paul was a bass or tenor or Silas was, you know, it doesn't say that at all. It just says they praying and singing hymns to God. So one of the things we can do when we're fearful is seek the presence of God in our lives. Invite God to be near us. And I think we see that illustrated here, that God is near, but you want to know he's near, right? And so you invite him, and that's what they were doing. They were praying and singing hymns to God. Now, I don't know whether they were praying in the sense of, Lord, get us out of here, or Lord, that was unfair, or Lord, give us an opportunity to talk to the jailer. You know, I doubt that that last one was really what they were praying about, even thinking about. I don't know. It doesn't tell us that. And they are not privy to the earthquake coming, I don't think. It doesn't say that they knew that God was going to respond to their prayers with an earthquake and shake open the doors and so on. They didn't know what God was going to do, but they knew God would do for them what they needed. And that's a hard thing for us to hang on to, I think, today. Don't you find it hard sometimes to believe that God will do something? You know, we pray to him. Like Corey had a beautiful prayer tonight and talked about the will of God in his prayer. And we struggle how to assemble our wants and desires and needs that we lift up to God. And on the other side, not sure what he's going to do about it. You know, we want to pray in faith, and maybe there's a difference between the faith that prays to God and trusts that he'll do the right thing as opposed to the faith that expects him to do what we think is the right thing. So we struggle with that sometimes. We don't always know how to pray or what to pray for. And thankfully we have the Spirit that is helping us in our needs as far as finding the right words. I mean, all the time, I don't know how to pray. I visit the hospital a lot. And many of the people of our congregation that are hospitalized are older. Not all, obviously, but many are. Some have some very difficult decisions to make about their health care. And sometimes the prayers that they ask for, I guess I just don't know what to expect. If God's going to answer that way or not. And I try to pray with them in such a way that we build confidence in God at being at work and doing what's best. But we struggle with that. So I guess the big lesson is pray anyway. Pray anyway. The second lesson, you know, I think we overlook the importance of singing hymns to God. I know we get into conversations occasionally with people about, you know, well, you guys are the ones that don't use music or don't have music. And of course, we would argue back, well, sure, we have music. We just sing it, you know. But, you know, that's not the point here. The point is that we're singing to praises to God. I mean, I doubt they had a guitar and violin or anything with them. So, you know, it's probably a good example of a cappella singing. But, you know, that would be a constructed argument that somebody could probably tear down. But the point being, they were singing hymns to God. It didn't require anything besides their voices and their faith. And we need to spend more time doing that, whether it's as a church, whether it's in the shower, in the car, wherever we go. And one of the outcomes of that is if we become more comfortable doing that, people will listen. People will listen, just like these guys, these prisoners that were there. Well, I also want to talk about the jailer and his family. You know, the story is, what must I do to be saved? And they replied, Paul and Silas, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. And then it says, the next thing that happened, they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. And then their wounds were washed, they were baptized, and then they ate. And there was joy. The reason being because he had come to believe in God, he and his whole household. What are some questions you have about this passage? We'll turn it from me talking to you, you talking to me, and maybe I'll talk back. So what are some questions or observations that you have about this whole story? What would you say is the powerful message that Luke, inspired writer, wanted us to have? What do you think? Yeah. Makes you wonder a little bit about the timing too, you know. Maybe they were took them that long to get to the point that they could even sing and pray, because they're beat up pretty badly. Whatever your situation, we need to be concerned about the souls of those who are lost. Okay. What can we do? Do we do that? I mean, to be honest, do you struggle to do that? Most of us know that's true, that we need to be concerned about those around us, and we need to be concerned about our impact, you know, what we're doing. We are being observed, just as we observe other people. You know, as we observe somebody and say, you're going the wrong way, they're observing us and seeing maybe a better way. So what do we do? I was with one of our ladies that's in the hospital today, and we were talking pretty extensively, and she was sharing that her view and understanding of Scripture is that we're put on this earth that we make the most of the time that we have. Now, she's probably more of a type A personality, to be honest, and so she feels very, very called to make the most of every minute, to be busy. And I know not everybody's probably wired that same way. But I thought her comment interesting, that, you know, when she has a minute, she needs to be doing something for the Lord. And, you know, we may think, well, there's nothing I can do. Well, what they did was powerful. Yeah. What do you think about the way the prayer was answered by God? What are some of the answers you see that, you know, God did answer their prayer, right? Although we don't even have the words of the prayer. Earthquake.
Foundations
break. Doors are opened.
Doors open.
What about the part of the story that is so surprising? Nobody leaves. You know, that's God at work. You're unshackled. You're free to go, but you stay. So God answers our prayers in some very strange ways sometimes, sometimes very unexpected ways. What's the other more important way, maybe, of all of this? What did this story lead to, or this event lead to?
Souls being added to the church.
Souls being added to the church. Anybody, by the way, ever wondered what the name of the jailer was? There's some clues that might or might not give his name elsewhere in Scripture. This is kind of an aside, not really important to our study, but Paul talks about the first people who were converted, and he uses the term Achaia, and this is Macedonia, so it may not be the same person. But in 1 Corinthians, I'll give you the reference, 1 Corinthians 1:16, and also chapter 16 of 1 Corinthians, verse 15 through 17. The reason I wanted to mention that, whether it's his name or not, the church in Philippi became very important to Paul. And, you know, we don't know that it ever became a large church. It may have been a jailer, a slave girl, and a wealthy woman in the households of the jailer and of Lydia. That may have been it. Don't know. It may have grown significantly, but in any case, that was the church that supported, voluntarily supported the work of Paul. And this is one of the foundational moments. This story is a foundational moment of that church. Now, you probably have somebody in your congregation that has been here a long time and maybe has worked on the history of the church here in Cabot. Jim's done that since he grew up in the church there at Northside. He's worked a lot on that over the years, trying to put together a summary of when the church started, you know, where it first met, who were the first people. Well, if you did that for the church in Philippi, this is it. This is it. Pretty important story. So if you look at 1 Corinthians 16, verses 15 through 17, you know that the household of Stephanas were the first converts in Achaia, and they have devoted themselves to the service of the Lord's people. I urge you, brothers and sisters, to submit to such people and to everyone who joins in the work and labors at it. I was glad when Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Achaicus arrived because they have supplied what was lacking from you, for they refreshed my spirit and yours also. Such men deserve recognition. Well, if that was him, who would have thought that a jailer who washed the wounds of two men in the middle of the night and took care of them, risking his own life, risking his professional life, risking his family's life, would be one of the people that Paul relies on years later? Let's pray. Father, thank you for letting us open your word tonight. We thank you for this great story. We see in each of these individuals that are introduced fear, whether it's the magistrates concerned about order and disorder, whether it's the jailer concerned about his own life, and whether it's Paul and Silas who are exemplary in what they do in the face of fear, is praying and singing praises to you, or whether it's the magistrates and officers who are fearful at the end of the story because of their mistake. Father, help us to learn as we read the stories of Scripture. Help us to see reflections in our own lives and learn from the great examples that we see, such as Paul and Silas. Help us to trust you more. Help us to be willing to do things that may seem awkward in certain situations, such as praying in public or singing loudly in the car about you and praises, knowing that others are watching. Others may pay attention. We don't do it for attention, but we do it for you. Bless us, Father, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you all. Enjoyed being with you. Thank you.